Now I want to discuss the remaining time about rockets. A rocket experiences an impulse from the engine, and that changes the momentum of the rocket. But before we go into the details of the rocket, think about again this idea of throwing objects on the floor. And let's turn to tomatoes. I want tomatoes because I want a complete inelastic collision. So tomatoes hit the floor, and it's not that I'm not only going to throw one tomato on the floor, but I'm very angry today, and I'm going to throw a lot of these tomatoes on the floor. N, as in Nancy, tomatoes on the floor. If one tomato hits the floor, the change of momentum is mv, if m is the mass of the tomato. But I'm going to throw n on the floor, so the change of momentum is n, as in Nancy, times the mass of the tomato times v. And this is the number of kilograms per second of tomatoes that I throw on the floor. So this is a change of momentum. And so this equals delta p divided by delta t. And that's an average force. So the floor will experience a force in down direction. Of course, that was also the case here when the ball experienced a force up, which we calculated here. The floor experienced, of course, the same force in down direction. Action equals minus reaction, Newton's third law. So the floor experiences a force in down direction. And I can write it down in a somewhat more civilized form. F equals dN dt times the velocity, if the velocity of the tomatoes that hit the floor is constant. And we're going to apply this to rockets, whereby the exhaust out of rockets has relative to the rocket a constant speed. And this is then the number of kilograms per second that I throw on the floor. This is very real. I can throw these tomatoes on a bathroom scale. And if I threw 4 kilograms per second on a bathroom scale, and they hit the bathroom scale with 5 meters per second, you better believe it that you will see that the bathroom scale will reach an average force of about 20 newtons, 4 times 5. If it weren't tomatoes, but if they were super balls which would bounce up, then the momentum change would be double, and so the bathroom scale would indicate 40 newtons. So this is a real thing. It's a real force that you can record. Now I'm going to be a little bit unpleasant to you. I'm going to throw rotten tomatoes at you. Here you are. And I have here a tomato. And this tomato has zero speed to start with. Let me make you a little bigger, otherwise I won't even hit you. So this is you. And so I give this tomato a certain velocity, v of x. The tomato hits you. Maybe it stays there, it's possible. Maybe it will drip down. But in any case, the velocity in the x direction is gone. So it hits you with a velocity vx, and then v of x equals zero. And it may make a mess. You will experience a force if I keep throwing these tomatoes at you all the time, and this is the force that you will experience. And that force is, of course, in this direction. You get all these tomatoes, and you feel that as a force. But now look at the symmetry of the problem. Here, the velocity goes from Vx to zero. But I, throwing the tomatoes, has to increase the velocity from zero to Vx. So for obvious reasons, I must then feel a force in this direction. Think of it as a recoil when you fire a bullet. So I experience exactly the same force, but in this direction. And that now is the idea behind a rocket. A rocket is spewing out tomatoes, well, not quite tomatoes, it's spewing out hot gas, in this direction, and then the rocket will experience a force in that direction. That is the basic concept behind a rocket. And the higher the speed of the gas that it throws out, the higher that velocity, the more kilograms per second it spits out, the higher the MDT, the higher will be the force on the rocket, and this force on the rocket is called the thrust of the rocket. So if we have a rocket in space, here's the rocket. And the rocket is spewing out gas with a velocity u, which is fixed relative to the rocket. It's a burning of chemical energy. Chemicals are burned. It comes out with a certain speed. And the rocket will then experience a force, which we call the thrust. And that is given by this equation. If you know how many kilograms per second are spewed out, and you know what the velocity is, which I've called u here, this will tell you what the thrust is of that rocket. If we take the case of the Saturn rockets that were used for the landing on the moon, Saturn. For the Saturn rockets, the speed u was about 2.5 kilometers per second. So the gas came out with 2.5 kilometers per second relative to the rocket. And the rate at which this gas was coming out is phenomenal. 15 tons of material per second. The MDT is about 15,000 kilograms per second. It's almost unimaginable. And that would give it then a thrust of about 35 million newtons, which, of course, was higher than the weight of the rocket. Otherwise, the rocket would never go up. An incredible thrust. I have also a nice problem for you in assignment 6 with the Saturn rockets. You will see these numbers again. These are rounded off. So rockets obtain an impulse from their engines. A force acts upon the rockets for a certain amount of time. We call that the burn time. But as they burn the fuel, the mass of the rocket goes down because the fuel leaves. And therefore, the acceleration during the burn goes up because the mass goes down. And this makes it somewhat complicated to derive the velocity change that you get during the burn, during this impulse. It's done in your book, Ohanian. I find that derivation a little bit complicated. I looked in other books, and I found one in the book by Tipler on physics. And his derivation, and I will go through that in general terms, I put that on the web for you. It should be there tonight. So you may want to take very few notes. The entire derivation, of which I will just highlight the important issues, is on the web. And the way that Tipler is doing it is exclusively from your frame of reference. You are sitting in 26100, and you are seeing this rocket go up. Let's keep that equation, which is the thrust of the rocket. Except that in the case of a rocket, we would call this u, which is the speed of the exhaust relative to the rocket, and this is what we call the thrust. So let's now take a rocket, which at time t, as seen from your frame of reference, where you are sitting, I use v's, it's your frame of reference, is going up with a velocity v. The mass of the rocket is m. And now we're going to look at time t plus delta t. The rocket has increased its speed, v plus delta v. The mass is m. Let me do that in, not in color. The mass is now m minus delta m. And here is a little bit of exhaust that was spewed out with velocity u relative to the rocket. U relative to the rocket. So u in 26100 will see the velocity of this little piece delta m. You will see this to be v minus u. If the velocity of the rocket is larger than u, could be, you will see the exhaust going up from your frame of reference. If the velocity of the exhaust is larger than the velocity of the rocket, from your frame of reference, you will see it go down. That's taken care of in the science. Now, I'm going to compare the momentum here with the momentum there. And we take the situation that there are no external forces acting upon it. Somewhere in outer space, this rocket burns. Momentum must be conserved. The momentum at time t equals m times v. That is very simple. That is time t. The momentum at time t plus delta t of the entire system, including the exhaust. If I'm telling you that momentum is conserved, you can't ignore the exhaust. It's momentum of the system that is conserved. The momentum of the rocket is going to change, and the momentum of the exhaust is going to change, but not of the system. So we're going to get mass times velocity, m minus delta m times v plus delta v, plus delta m, which has a velocity v minus u. And how large is this? Well, there is mv plus m delta v, here you see the m delta v, here you see the mv, and then you get minus u delta m, and the delta mv here cancels minus delta mv here, and this term, delta m delta v, is the product of two incredibly small numbers. I ignore that. So this is the momentum at t plus delta t, and this is the momentum at time t, and so the change in momentum, delta p, which must be zero, because momentum is conserved, is m delta v minus u delta m. M delta v minus u delta m. I can take the derivative of this equation, so I get on the left side the PdT. The PdT is going to be zero. So I get zero equals m times dv dt, but dv dt is the acceleration rocket, minus u dm dt. And that is the thrust on the rocket. So what you see here is something that is very easy to digest, that ma, which is the this is the acceleration of the rocket, this is the mass of the rocket at time t, equals the thrust of the rocket, and that equals u dm dt. And some people call this the rocket equation. Now, this is true if there is no external force on the system. It is interesting to include a real launch from Earth. And if you have a real launch from Earth, then the rocket is going up in this direction, but then gravity is exactly in the opposite direction. In other words, only when you launch vertically from Earth would you have a thrust like this, and you would have mg like this. In that case, this equation has to be adjust it, and then you get ma equals m thrust minus mg. Only if you have a launch from Earth vertically up. Now you have to do a little bit of massaging, and I will leave you with that massaging. A couple of integrals are necessary to convert this into the final velocity of the rocket after the burn. compared to the initial velocity. And that part I will leave you with, but you will see that worked out in all detail on the notes that I left on the web. And then you come up with a very famous equation that the final velocity of the rocket minus the initial velocity of the rocket equals minus u times the logarithm of the final mass of the rocket divided by the initial mass of the rocket. This is if there were no gravity at all. Just in case and only in case of a vertical launch from Earth, there is also here a term minus gt. Only if you have a vertical launch from Earth. When I watched my lecture, I noticed that in my enthusiasm, I put brackets around the minus gt. And this is quite misleading because it may give you the wrong impression that there's a product at stake here, which is not so. So the brackets really should not be around the minus gt. It is this term, minus u logarithm of mf divided by m of I, minus gt.